lunch symposium, so why don't you find a place for you, and I ask the panelists or the speakers to find a seat, and we wait for one more minute.
English is not my mother language for me, but yeah, but in Korean, English is very difficult, so I'm slightly nervous.
Okay, I think we need to continue. So good afternoon, my name is Lauri Handolin, coming from Helsinki University Hospital, and I'm chairing this Tokai lunch symposium. And pay attention, it's not Tokai, it's Tokai. That's what I learned from Japan. To means something eastern, so Tokai is something coming from the east of Japan, maybe. So this symposium will be the Tokai lunch symposium. We are going to have three presentations, and we can discuss shortly after each presentation, and in the end we try to save some time for questions also. And we are planning to stop or close just before the next session so that you would have time to quickly visit the bathroom or whatever you need to do. So let's start. So first, let me first introduce our first speaker. He's Dr. Yosuke Matsumura, coming from Japan. He graduated in 2005 from Chiba University, Japan, and he's been working in the radiological unit for 1 year, but actually he graduated himself as an emergency medicine doctor in 2012. He also did the critical care fellowship, and currently he's working in shock trauma unit, shock trauma Baltimore, as a visiting research fellow in endovascular trauma. And his experience started with the RIBOA. He started in 2007, and so far he has 15 clinical cases taken care by using RIBOA. So, Dr. Matsumura, please.
Hey, thank you, Tal and Program Committee, and thank you, Lauri, for introduction. And I want to thank Tokai Medical Products to help this presentation. My name is Yosuke Matsumura. I'm originally came from Japan, but I'm doing visiting researcher in the United States today. So today I'd like to introduce the trends in trauma US and Japan. So here's my disclosure. So let me introduce my case in Japan first. A 30-year-old female fell from fifth floor. She's pregnant, transferred directly from the scene. The BP, on admission, BP was 50 over 28, and the baby was almost dead, so we gave up the baby and tried to rescue her. This is the first chest X-ray. It seems okay, but we have some rib fracture and subcutaneous emphysema, and she has the pelvic fracture. Now, first was unknown, unfortunately, she was pregnant. And we each intubate heart, a maximum transfusion, and rebore at zone one, the complete occlusion. So now he's inflating the balloon. So we decide to go to IR for pelvis. Then hysterectomy planned if needed. I embolized the bilateral internal iliacly quickly. So this is the last picture after NVC embolization. This is the time from 70 minutes from the arrival, and the procedure time was about 15. SBP was 100, but still unstable. So we scanned the patient on the angio table. Fortunately, we have a CT scan in the angio room. But this CT scan showed the pericardial hematoma and left massive hemothorax. And then she rapidly deteriorated. Unfortunately, we lost her. Probably she might have the heart injury and multiple rib injury. So in this case, Rivora does not work well. So let's talk about the trauma background, US and Japan. In Japan, road traffic accident and fatalities and injuries are decreasing. So the fatality in Japan is now below 4,000 in 2016. So the number of trauma cases is decreasing. At least compared to the United States and Japan, the population about 2.5 times in the US, and the fatality in traffic accidents is about 8 or 9 times. So we have a less number of trauma. This is due to the technology and a multifaceted approach. In the United States, now I'm belonging to the Shock Trauma Center in Baltimore. This is a really beautiful harbor city. But this is the another fact of the Baltimore. It's a really dangerous city. So the topic of United States and Japan, actually this theme is too big to me. So let's compare the area where I live, the Maryland and Chiba. Chiba is next to Tokyo, and Chiba has a Narita International Airport. So if you have a chance to come to Japan, you will land on Chiba first. And I found several similarities between Maryland and Chiba. The both neighborhoods are capital city, and population is almost the same, 6 million. Maryland held 6 times larger area, but only 2 level trauma center, and practically most patients will go to the shock trauma center. On the other hand, in Chiba, we have 12 tertiary care hospitals, and each individual hospital will care the trauma patient. This is a comparison between shock trauma and average Japan trauma data bank data. Total annual trauma case in shock trauma is over 6,000, but in Japan, only 100. So shock trauma has 60 times the number of trauma compared to average Japan. And they have a lot of penetrating patients, but it's very rare in Japan. Japan is a safe country. But we have a lot of elderly population. Basically, more than half patients are over 55 or 60. This is a common standard concept, I think. The concept of golden hour is suggested by Dr. Al-Adamas Cowley. And in Maryland, they can effectively centralize the patient into the high-skilled, sophisticated volume center. And they have huge resource, huge surgical resource. But unfortunately, I'm sorry to say, in Japan, we have very few number of trauma surgeons. We have general surgeons, they are skilled, but they don't like to operate the trauma patient. They love electric cases. In addition, the endovascular approach is getting spread rapidly in the United States on huge and skilled surgical skill, so they have the double sword. And in Japan, this is the data from our direct IABO, the Rebar registry. The time from the admission to the surgery is about 1 hour. And the other JTDB data bank analysis showed 90 minutes or 100 minutes. Of course, it's way too long, but unfortunately, this is the fact in Japan. So we have no choice but to expand the indication of the endovascular approach. So we need to do aggressive diagnostic and interventional radiology, emergency, critical care, and trauma. This is the name of DIRECT. So I'd like to divide my talk into three parts. The first section is Reboa CT. I realize this is a controversial issue, but I would say this. So Reboa definitely contributes to elevate proximal SVP. So Reboa may give us chance to scan the hemodynamically unstable patient. Do you think, is it crazy? The probably classical ATLS concept denied this. But if you use partial occlusion, we can get the contrast enhanced image like this. But is it dangerous or not? It highly depends on how long you stay in the CT room. This is a picture of a trauma CT scan I cited from EVTM website. The trauma patient has a lot of tube lines devices, so we need to take, sometimes it takes a long time, but scan time itself is usually very, very quick thanks to recent technology. But the crucial issue is transfer to CT and preparation, and after scanning, transfer to stretcher. So I invented this device. We call this backboard tree, BBT. I attach this device to the backboard, and we can hang every device and every blood product transfusion on this to this device. So we can transfer the patient without any move from we don't have to move the blood transfusion and any device. But we can transfer as one unit. And I compare the transfer time from the stretcher to the CT bed and post-CT means from the CT bed to the stretcher. If we use the backboard tree, we can successfully reduce the time, transfer time. So this is a BBT backboard tree may be useful, maybe contribute to the Reboa CT for safe scanning. And next most important part is multidisciplinary trauma team training. Dr. John Matsumoto, he's my mentor, discussed this issue in the morning session. And after appropriate training and in his institute, they could successfully reduce the time of the duration in the CT room, not the scan time, whole entire process to the 7 minutes. So trauma team training will be definitely useful to scan the unstable patient. So Reboa may give us a chance to scan the hemodynamically unstable patient. Is it crazy? Yeah, I wouldn't say it's crazy. It may change the disposition of the patient. It may shorten the time to complete the hemostasis, and not the start, complete the hemostasis. And it may find unexpected bleeding, particularly in elderly, blunt, polytrauma patient. So let's move on to the second topic. Excuse me. Arrival to angiography time. So this is a flow diagram of the usual initial assessment to the angiography. We got the patient here, and primary survey, CT scan, and then go to the angiography. This is a usual strategy. But in real setting, in many cases, in many hospitals, probably we need to consult IR and wait for IR, so it can delay. So this is the data from the United States, from the Houston. So in the pelvic fracture patient, the time from admission to the IR was over 3 hours or 5 hours. And this is the data from shock trauma. Again, in the pelvic fracture patient, the time from admission to the angiography is over 4 hours. Look at the Japanese data. This is the paper of my colleague, Dr. Tanaka. She enrolled a pelvic fracture patient and measured the time from admission to the IL, and the time was about 18 minutes. Actually, we did not satisfy this number. And the other study, this is the paper of Dr. Seno. Oh, this population is more severe, the patient who required NVCA, like a glue injection. In this case, the time from admission to the IR was 60 or 80 minutes. So arrival to angiography time, of course, this is crucial to of the indication of the IR for hemodynamically unstable patient. And next, this is a technical matter, I think. Embolization time. So we measure the procedure time, the from first skin, first shot and the final shot, and measure time and divide by the number of embolized artery. We call this this number the SAET, single artery embolization time. It means time to cannulate and inject and embolize, then confirm. So this is data from shock trauma. The embolization procedure time was 51 minutes. And this is the data of Japan. The procedure time was 36 and 40. And SAET was about 7 minutes per each vessel. And this is a study of NBCA pelvic fracture patient. The procedure time was 20 or 12 minutes, and SAET was about 5 minutes. And interestingly, a re-embolization rate, if we choose NBCA first, we have significantly lower re-embolization, meaning the recanalization rate. So it's a reliable embolic agent. So pan scan in 7 minutes. Is it okay for reverse CT? I have no answer, appropriate answer at present. But there is a possibility to utilize a reverse CT. And time go to angio 60 to 80 minutes. Yeah, I'm not satisfied with this number, but we need to shorten more and more. And pelvic embolization 12 to 20 minutes, and SAET 5 to 6 minutes. This is due to the CT navigation of the CT data. So reverse CT may contribute to decrease the procedure time. So I won't say this aggressive. I would say our strategy is time conscious diagnostic and interventional radiology in trauma. So golden hour is not only for the surgery, damage control surgery. A golden hour should be implemented in the EVTM or any other endovascular procedure. Then we can indicate IR for the hemodynamically unstable patient. By the way, this is a picture I showed in the of the case. We cannot see any perfusion in the light rack. Actually, in this time, we use 10 French catheter, 10 French river catheter. Unfortunately, we got her, but currently, there are several kinds of river catheter and sheath. The 12 French used to be common in the United States, and 11 French currently used in Sweden and other European countries. And we used to use 10 French, and now mainly use 7 French. And now United States has the 7 French other catheter. So again, such small profile catheter will rescue not only lives, but also legs. So this is the benefit of small profile catheter. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Yosuke. Very good perspective of the Japanese protocol. And yeah, if we look at the number of penetrating trauma, it's only, I calculated, 3.1%. So mainly everything is planned. And probably this is the reason that enables you to manage your patients like you are doing. I mean, only by diagnostics with CT and then taking care of the bleeding in endovascular means, because very seldom in blunt trauma, even though sometimes you have some hollow viscous, hollow organ injury you need to operate on. So, but probably when you have more like penetrating trauma, then you need to have more open surgery, maybe not for the bleeding, but to take care of the hollow organ injuries as well.
Yes, I totally agree with you. In Japan, penetrating is very, very rare. So, and our general population is geriatric, so particularly blunt geriatrics, we sometimes experience the unexpected bleeding. And so that is the partially because we want to scan the patient and identify the each bleeding site.
Of course, and in blunt trauma, you always have, very often you have severe head injury. You need to have the CT to see what's going on in the head. Okay, any comments or questions from the audience? There is one. Carlos, just raise your voice. Yeah, the question was the first case Yosuke was presenting the pregnant lady, why to put a reboa on mother? Why don't you start with a C-section to save the baby? Save the mother.
Yeah, we are preparing the hysterectomy simultaneously, but we have the pelvic fracture as well, and internal iliac embolization will contribute both pelvic fracture and stop the bleeding from uterus. So my decision was first reboa, then IR, then hysterectomy. But this is a really difficult case, so I'm not sure this is the right answer. And more worse, she has the chest injury. So I'm not. I don't know who. I don't know how we can save her.
Okay, thank you. Any more? If not, we thank you, Yosuke. And we continue. The next speaker, Dr. Sung Wok Chang. He's coming from South Korea. He graduated as a medical doctor in 2000 from Dankook University, South Korea. He's been working in the Department of Thoracic and Cardiovascular Surgery, and did his fellowship in Samsung Medical Center 2008, trauma surgery 2013, critical care 2015. And he said that he did his first reboa in 2015. Now 6 patients so far treated by reboa. So please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm Sung-wook Chang from Dankook University Hospital in South Korea. It's a great honor to present this topic in this meeting. Today, I would like to talk about the nation-designated trauma center in South Korea and introduce my institute. My topic is divided into 4 sections: before, progress, after, and my institution. Now, I would like to start my presentation. Injury is the one of the leading causes of death in South Korea by CDC. Injury ranks 3rd as a cause of death for all age groups. Especially under the age of 44, injury is the most leading cause of death in South Korea. Regardless, intentional or unintentional death, the impact of injury is further emphasized when comparing the total years of potential life lost before age 60 years. Therefore, injury imposes a heavy burden on society in terms of both mortality and morbidity, along with the economic burden on society. In 2008, there were 21 regional emergency center and 110 local centers and 306 clinics for emergency treatment in South Korea. In general, regional and local centers should open 24/7 and provide the care. But there were differences between regional and local centers. Generally, there were specialties and residents in regional centers. However, in local centers, there were a few specialty without residents. So the most injured patients were available to be treated in regional emergency center. Therefore, in the case of patients requiring emergency surgery, there is a severe problem because of the shortage of doctor and environment. Furthermore, there was a more bigger problem. All patients visited the regional or local centers, so severe ill patients were difficult to be received the adequate treatment because of the patient crowding and lack of manpower and environment. As a result, among the severe patients due to trauma, only 13% patients were treated in centers. It proved to be insufficient trauma specialties and environment to deal with the patient. So unfortunately, preventable death rate is very high. Therefore, in order to solve this problem, the special trauma center for severe injured patients were planned to reinforce the trauma care by government. Now, projected the special trauma center candidate was planned by government. In January 2009, 9 trauma center candidates were designated by government. There are near the metropolitan area in Seoul, Gyeonggi-do, and Incheon first. In near future, it would be planned to increase the special trauma center nationwide. However, 2 years later, the problem about the crowded patients and delayed management could not solve. The question is why this happened? There were several reasons. First, government support such as finance and insurance were not sufficient. Second, candidate hospital did not provide the sufficient medical services because each hospital suffered from a lot of financial losses. Furthermore, the shortage of trauma specialty and surgeon had become more serious. So the government and the Korean Society of Traumatology focused on the problem. First, subspecialty course for trauma surgeon was established. During 2 years more training course after the specialty of surgery, such as general surgery, thoracic surgery, or neurosurgery, etc. Second, they focused on the coordination of regional emergency center and trauma center for decreasing the final losses. The government would provide more finance and insurance coverage. Now, the nation designated trauma center was started. The aim of nation designated trauma centers was as follows: provide effective hospital care and early and adequate critical care and placed well-trained trauma teams and prevent loss of life. First, the government formally announced a five-nation designated trauma center in November 2012 and then increased them to 17 centers till 2017 nationwide. The government provided $7 million for equipment and environment per one center and $100,000 for trauma physician, and maximum 23 physicians could be supported. Each hospital should provide the other personal expenses and the other cost. In 2009, two centers were allowed before the planning, the nation designated trauma center. One of them in Seoul is the headquarters. Thereafter, five centers in 2012, four centers, and five centers are gradually allowed throughout the country. At present, 16 trauma centers are allowed, but only 9 trauma centers have been opened in accordance with national criteria and the other designated trauma centers are going to be prepared to open because of national criteria is very strict. The nation designated trauma center is as follows. First, equipment and environment. The trauma center should have the control room manager. The manager supports to deal with monitoring and telephone counseling about transfer in and out or transportation. The triage and observation is performed in 6 beds area. The purpose of triage in trauma center is to determine the priority so that limited medical resources were allocated to patients who will receive the most benefit. If patients with lesser severity of injuries may be transported to appropriate another emergency center. There were 2 resuscitation rooms with anesthetic machine and surgical instrument, so trauma physician could perform the resuscitation and damage control surgery, such as resuscitative thoracotomy, preperitoneal packing, reboa, ECMO insertion, etc. After resuscitation, patients would be transferred to the operating room or intervention room or intensive care unit. The trauma center must have 2 operating rooms. In there, the patient would undergo the major surgery, such as open heart surgery. However, there is a limitation of using the room. The operating room is allowed for only injured patient. If 2 rooms are busy, center should prepare the another operating room for emergency patient after trauma. There are 20 beds in trauma ICU and 40 beds in general ward. So the patient could be treated in trauma center without the shortage of the bed as soon as possible. Likewise, the operating room system, beds in ICU and ward are allowed for only injured patient. Now, I'll talk about the trauma physician. Trauma physicians are divided into 2 groups. One is the duty and the other is support group. The duty group consists of general surgeon, thoracic and cardiovascular surgeon, neurosurgeon, or orthopedic surgeon, or the emergency medical doctor. And the support group consists of interventional radiology, intensive medicine, backup surgeon, etc. Among the duty group, the prior 3 departments are obligations, and the last 2 are options. Also, there is a big difference between duty group and support group. The doctor of duty group should stay in the hospital on duty day, and if they receive the emergency call, they should arrive within 10 minutes and immediately start. On the other hand, the doctor of support group is not obligated to stay in the hospital on duty day, but if they receive the call, they could arrive within 1 hour and support the treatment. And like this system, trauma center have an obligation to organize the trauma activation team, about 3 teams or more. Consequently, equipment environment and trauma physicians are ready for injured patient, and we could provide a more effective hospital care. So I hope to prevent loss of life from preventable causes, and I hope to improve outcomes too. As a result, preventable death rate is slightly decreased. In 2016, the panel discussion was done by CDC. Trauma centers and local emergency centers were analyzed. In the same method as before, 1,600 patients were extracted sampling and enrolled. The graph shows an improvement rather than the previous survey. However, the prevent death rate is still high. Finally, let me introduce my institute. Dankook University Hospital is located in Cheonan. Cheonan City is located in 80 kilometers south of the capital in Seoul. Cheonan has been called the core city of the nation, as it is gateway to the area around the national capital region, the main transportation hub for the national road, railways, and expressionways. we have two resuscitation rooms, and we perform the resuscitation and damage control surgery. After resuscitation, damage control or defeat surgery could be performed in the trauma operating room if necessary. The essential equipment, such as cardiopulmonary bypass machine, is ready too. The operating room is forbidden to use in patients with diseased patients. There are 20 beds in trauma ICU and 40 beds in trauma ward. Two beds in the ICU are the isolation area with negative air conditioning system, and 18 beds are located in the opened system. The flight view picture shows the Dankook School of Medicine and Dankook University Hospital. There are emergency center, trauma center, and heliport for Dr. Heli. Helipad is not located on the roof of building. We have a surface level of helipad. After landing of a helicopter, the patient is transferred to center by ambulance. It takes about 3 minutes from helipad to resuscitation room. There is an important difference. Fortunately, we can use the Dr. Heli not only trauma patient, but also disease patient. So January 2016, the project of Dr. Heli was started. November 9th, we have 200 transferring cases with Dr. Heli. Among them, severe trauma patients is the most common. This is annual report of my institution. 2,420 patients visited the trauma center after injury. Among them, there were 435 severe patients. And there were 137 patient death cases, including death on arrival cases. Among death cases, mean injury severity score was 26 and TRIS was 47. Overall death rate is 5.7, but preventable death rate is 12% by CDC and panel discussion. For example, I will show the video in my case. The patient presented at trauma bay from 8-meter fall down injury. He had an unstable and multiple pelvic bone fracture. Vital signs were unstable too. So we performed the reboa via left femoral artery with Selding technique. We don't have a hybrid room, so we checked the serial X-ray for location of guide wire and balloon tip. After the completion of balloon inflation, we performed the preperitoneal pelvic packing for damage control surgery. So after completion, we transferred the patient to the intervention room for an embolization. After embolization, vital signs were stable, and CT scan showed the unstable spine fracture too. One day later, we removed the packed gauze and reboa catheter and sheath. Several days later, we completed the operation of pelvic bone and spine fracture. Finally, he discharged home. All right, finally, what is needed for successful trauma care? We need key players for establishing strong leadership in major trauma care. I think the trauma center is the one of them. And for trauma care, other surgical specialties are necessary too. But actually, the role of trauma center and team is not all about the trauma care system. Because pre-hospital care, transportation, injury prevention is more or equally important too. Therefore, the organizational support and institutional support should be continuous. I'm sure that these all efforts would result in good outcome. I really appreciate you inviting me, and thank you for your attention. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Chang. Very interesting talk, and it seems that you've been doing a lot. nationwide, nationally guided work on creating trauma systems, and seems that your results, you are getting there. Still, it seems that there are some hill to climb, but results are getting better all the time. My question to you would be, have you done anything with EMS teaching or the education of EMS personnel, dispatch centers, because also by putting some resources on there, you can increase your results.
Thank you for your question. This is very important. The trauma center had a role to educate the EMS and pre-hospital care. So we have about 4 or 6 per year education program for EMS and triage. But now, only 9 trauma center has opened in this time. So several years later, maybe the pre-hospital care and EMS and transportation is better than 2016, I think so.
Good. Okay, comments, questions from the floor, anything? I can't see any hands, so thank you, Dr. Chang.
Thank you so much.
And we continue to our last speaker in this Tokai lunch symposium. He's Dr. Michael Stein, Mickey Stein, coming from Israel. He graduated as a medical doctor in 1979 from Tel Aviv University, Israel. After that, he's been serving more than 20 years in the Israel military for different kind of responsibilities. He graduated as a general surgeon in 1991 from Sheba Medical Center, and also did his time in Mount Sinai, New York. In 1993 to 1995, he did his trauma fellowship in Shock Trauma Center. And 1998, he started to work in Rabin Medical Center, currently being the head of trauma and acute care surgery, and also vice president for the surgical division in Rabin Medical Center. So please welcome.
Well, thank you. Good afternoon. I want to thank Talher for inviting me and for Tokai Medical for making it possible for me to come here. And I have to apologize. First of all, I wasn't sure how long I have to speak. And the other apology is, I think it's the first time I'm giving a lecture about a procedure that I've never done. It's quite difficult. Well, I heard about it for a long time, and I think the first time was, in Australia, where I met Karim Brohi, and he mentioned it, and John Holcomb also said maybe that's the thing for the future. So I've been looking back at my experience in the operating room, there were quite a lot of times where I said, well, I should have had this instrument with me now. But I'll try to give you just an overview of the Israeli setup. I won't go very deep into it, but just to give you an idea, this is, we're quite a small place here in the eastern part of the Mediterranean. Many of you have been there, I suppose, with a lot of interesting neighbors that we have that produce some of the casualties. But that's a myth, because still the majority of casualties in Israel are, you won't even guess. It's not terror, it's not criminal, it's not even motor vehicle accidents, it's falls. Israelis fall from everywhere. They fall from the window, from the balcony, from the floor, even from the floor. So it's nearly 50% of all our trauma admissions. And now that we have quite an efficient trauma registry, we know that we have nearly 40,000 trauma admissions in all the trauma centers in the country. We have only 27 acute care hospitals, those who have an emergency department, and they vary in size. The biggest is 1,500 beds, that's the Sheba Medical Center, and the smaller ones are about 200 beds. We also have a designation, which is not like in the United States, but we have a sort of level one trauma center in the American concept, six formal ones, and in the last 3 years, we added actually two more, so we have eight. And we have another eight formal trauma centers, which are called regional trauma centers in Israel. It's sort of like a level three in the United States, because they don't have a neurosurgery department. So for that, they are considered the level three. And another 10 or 11 hospitals are treating trauma, but not officially called trauma centers, because they don't have trauma units and don't have trauma directors. Not many people know, but all the major trauma of the Palestinian Authority from the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, those who they don't have the level high enough to treatment, they transfer. Even terrorists, we treat them. And in our emergency, in our ICU now, there's at least two or three all the time. Israel is, we have nearly 8 million now, or a little more, which is in Sweden is about 10 million now, but the area is completely different, and we have a much smaller country. And from here down, from Beersheba down, there's hardly any population. It's all desert. So most of the 8 million and another 4 million of the Palestinian authorities are concentrated in this part of the country. Here, if you take out the West Bank, it's only 13 kilometers wide. And we have quite a concentrated area of trauma centers. The red ones are the level one, and the yellow ones are the level threes, which are trauma centers because they have trauma directors and trauma units. The pre-hospital setup is quite efficient, and it had to become efficient because of all the mass casualties that we had in the last 15 years or 20 years. And it includes a national system, which is called the Red Star of David, Magen David Adom, which have now about 80 what we call advanced intensive care mobile units. That's advanced paramedic capabilities. And another 500 ambulances, which we call a white ambulance or regular ambulance, which have a medic or a paramedic. But even if there is a paramedic there, he's the driver, so he cannot give advanced care during transit. So the evacuation times, as you can see, imagine from the map that I showed you before, is very short. It's only 10 or 30 minutes from any injury to a major trauma center, and that gives you an idea of maybe you start thinking about should we use something that is considering a REBOA or not in the field. There are also other various other smaller emergency medical services. The medevacs in Israel constitute of two types, the civilian one, which is a very small helicopter with two paramedics. You cannot provide care during flight. It's a very small helicopter. The military one, and they include only paramedics, very experienced, but paramedics. The military one has an MD and a paramedic and another medic, and they use either the HU-60, that's the Black Hawk, and the Sikorsky 53, which is quite a larger airplane, and you can provide care during flight. So, looking at the distances in our country, which are very small, one thinks of what can we do to stop bleeding for someone who's massively bleeding in the field. In my opinion, those who die from torso, from non-compressible areas, most of them will die in the field anyway. And the capability of the staff or the managers that can go very close, very quickly to the site, their capabilities are not that great. And in order for the few cases that we have every year, you'll have to train hundreds or even more of personnel to provide something they will maybe do once a year or twice a year. That doesn't seem reasonable. What we can do in the pre-hospital setup is, tourniquets, but that's for compressible sites. That's not the REBOA area, I think. Topical hemostat we used in the past. We played with that for 20 years. I don't think it works much. Chemical procoagulation products, we used to give in the military at least factor 7 for many years. We were the ones to blame for it. I think the first case was in Israel, published in 1999 in The Lancet, and we caused a big chaos in the world for 10 years, and then it died out. And then endovascular instrumentation in the EMS, one of my concerns is that from experience after dealing with trauma for more than 30 years in the civilian and military, we wanted to, if you give toys to someone, to kids, they will play with it. So the worst case scenario that I can think of happened in an explosion of a suicide bomber 200 meters from my hospital. The most severe case came after about 45 minutes. You could crawl quicker to the hospital. And he came out with a chest tube. And that's why he came so late. He came he was the last patient that came in, and he was the worst casualty. So if you give toys to someone, he will play with it. So that's my concern. In the military setup, I think it has a use, but only if you have a forward surgical team at hand immediately, because it's not realistic to put something that will occlude your aorta and then stand there and wait for 10 hours, because that's the next evacuation. If you have an FST team, and I was one of those who helped develop the teams in Israel, in scenarios that are crazy scenarios, maybe there has a role. If you go to the hospital level, then it becomes much more reasonable. The literature, if you look, most of the Israeli hospitals follow the guidelines of the Western Trauma Association guidelines for when to do an ED thoracotomy. And actually, the Reboa in Israel was introduced as something that will replace ED thoracotomies. So basically, it's if you have an arrest or a pre-arrest patient due to penetrating injury, that's probably yes for an instrumentation like that. Arrest due to blunt trauma, we don't suggest that you will save the patient by ED thoracotomy, but that's probably one of the more common cases that we will do. In real life, it's called in Israel, we don't publish the Don't mention that anywhere else. It's a resident training program, because we're trying to teach the residents how to do it to save the penetrating injury case that will come once every year. Anywhere in the country. I'm not talking about a single hospital. In the last 10 years, when the transplantation program has expanded in Israel, that's another excuse, especially in severe head injuries for penetrating gunshot wounds to the head, and he arrests. We made improve the rate of resuscitating the body in order to save organs, but that is not founded in the literature. So the difference will be whether during the trauma arrest we will end up with an aftermath of this, or if we open the chest, as we do several times a year, it will end up like this, and the Reboa will make a change. We'll go back to looking like this after resuscitation. In order to prepare this talk, I was asked to do like a small survey around the country, and it's not that difficult because it's only 27 hospitals. I talked with the trauma directors everywhere and try to find out what is the rate of ED thoracotomies that we are doing in order to see how many of these can we use to replace it with a Reboa procedure. And the numbers are quite small, as you can see. The survey was done last month. The smallest hospitals, they do up to 5 cases a year. And there's one hospital that is the champion, I won't mention who. By the way, it won't be too safe to be injured now in Israel, because half the trauma surgeons of Israel are in this room. I told my wife not to go out. And the total number per year for the whole country is about 60 to 80 patients that we performed ED thoracotomies. And most of them are due to blunt trauma, which is, if you will go strictly according to the algorithm, we probably shouldn't do half of them. Survival, no one wanted to tell me. No one wanted to tell me, so I can only guess. I can only give you my humble experience with the cases in my hospital. Last year we did 11 ED thoracotomies. There were no survivors, sadly. And I've been in that hospital for 18 years. I think we did about a little more than 100. maybe 110. We had 15 survivors that went to survive to reach the operating room or the ICU, seven of them penetrating trauma, eight blunt. Only four were discharged from the hospital with a functioning heart, two penetrating and two blunt, but sadly, 50% of them, two, were in a vegetative state. So this is very depressing. Maybe, if we use the Reboa, we'll have much higher numbers, and maybe that's a reason to use it. So the experience in Israel, actually only Dr. Kessel has experience with his intervention radiologist. They performed two cases. I think it was not a CODA, it was something else. But even they did not survive, so the experience until now is not that good. We heard on the BBC that people are trying to do that pre-hospital in London, and I understand some of it will be presented here. One of my colleagues, a good friend, Karim Brohi, I think he's from the same place where it was done. Some words of caution, while Reboa sounds relatively simple, it is an extremely difficult technology to deliver in an emergency department, in a hospital, never mind the roadside. And this is for one who is the proponent of that. And in spite of the fact that you get the feeling that it's very simple, as we heard in the last day and a half, I think it's not that simple, especially in the time frames here that were presented are amazing. You'll never get that in Israel. First of all, maybe it's with the climate. It's different. When it's warm, you get heated discussions. And when you have four Israelis, you'll have six opinions. So it'll take time. The procedure itself, it takes the same time. But in order to get to agree on it, will take time. So we have that problem in Israel. What is a supportive environment, in my opinion? First of all, probably it should be done in a major trauma center. The availability of trauma team should be there 24/7, also interventional radiology, especially if your trauma team is not that experienced. Existence of a hybrid room, which we still don't have in my hospital, is a very good, very big advantage. And now that we're going down, as mentioned here with the rescue balloon, to the 7 French size, that makes it much more comfortable and we feel better doing it. So maybe that will increase the use. And probably trauma will not be the most common cases to use it. In my opinion, it will be in acute care surgery. That's where I'll probably use it. I've been there in the operating room when I said, yeah, I wanted the Reboa here, and that was not a trauma patient. So, where should we use it? Well, going back in my experience with the military and the pre-hospital civilians, all our paramedics are trained in our hospitals, those who work around us. You shouldn't use it when the evacuation is less than 30 minutes, and you shouldn't use it when it's more than 60 minutes. So it's in that time frame. And I can't find many of the cases that we receive that fit there. The pre-hospital only, as I mentioned, with the FAST, with the FST available. In the ED and trauma resuscitation unit, in trauma centers, of course. More commonly will be used in angio suites, and the most common place, I think, will be in the OR or hybrid capabilities. So pre-hospital, crazy but feasible in the military. In civilian, still crazy but feasible. In the TRU, that will be the smallest group, and the largest group will be in the hybrid room. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Stein, for a very nice presentation. I'm afraid we are running a bit late, and we are already running over time. So we need to close here and continue with the next session. Thank you.